So, dear friends, now we have discussed this part of part 3 of discussion is the most important cases that come before the complicated issues, provisions of the code, and what is that they have been done, because I am sharing my experience only and it can be taken as inputs. Here, this is most important is the diversion of funds. Section 43, 45, 49 and 66. I have prepared a detailed PowerPoint presentation for the entire provisions of this, but what I would like to discuss here is, this is, I appeared in one case as a liquidator in our these things. You know, we all know that when the, who is the first person to know this company will go for CAR process or liquidation is only the promoters. Now, they, when they know they are in trouble, the asset, the corporate debt is in trouble, first thing is they will do is to make sure that the money is taken by them, the assets created by them are siphoned off through dubious means. Another thing they can do is they would have taken money, borrowed money from various people. Some innocent people would have given who should get first priority. They would have taken from their close friends. They would have been last priority in this law. So how to make the fifth one as first and first one will automatically become next. That is frauding the creditors whom you should pay. You gift the things. Now, every resolution professional, first duty for him is to see that he, based on the opinion, and I will explain all that very detailed presentation we have done, but I am taking a situation where the number of cases that were successful in Chennai with regard to 43, 49 are very few. In my case, it was successful. Because what happened is the stock was diverted. The promoter was running the business in CIR process, not given to the RP, the then RP. I was appointed as the liquidator. Immediately we filed a case and then took the possession of that. But then business was continued by him. So what your liquidator can do, thereafter only we could sell. That's another point. But here there is a, this again came to, we were the Honorable Sucharita Madam only. She agreed with our contention that the stock was there of that 70 crores. As soon as the order of the adjudicating authority came directing them to take over the possession, overnight he transferred the stock. We conducted a forensic audit report and showed them. So, based on the discussion, the issue Honorable Adjudicating Author raised was, all right, can you tell us where the money, these are all, this is a movable property. Suppose if you say this is the television and this television is there, I will pass orders for you to collect it. How can you prove that this will be, is there, because you would have sold it and converted it into cash. If it is a immovable property, no problem, property can be transferred back. But this means, how can we do it? That was the question. On that ground, they have dismissed that petition. Otherwise, they agreed to the, yes, fact is that the promoters have diverted. So now we are going to anklet, and that part we will discuss. But whenever you are talking about this 43, which is the most important provision of the entire code, because money is diverted before it comes to them. And that money, if you get back, the corporate debtor will survive. And it is duty cast upon resolution professional or liquidator to do that. So here is an advice for, we will give it to transaction audit will be given, forensic auditors, they will do something. I'll give a simple example of one case. where the forensic auditor said this is coming under 43 and 49. That is, this company was having surplus capacity, working only at 60%. When there is surplus capacity, the promoters have given it to sublet some part of the work, as a result of which the company has lost 25 crores of rupees. So that is one way in which promoters will take away the money. This is the point. That is looks very correct. You can, here you should know, most adjudicating authorities are not accounts in the background. They are supported by technical members, of course, but the way you present it to them, it becomes very important. Accounting standards are there, application of rules, or what is a fraud, what is a forensic audit, how do you do it? Everything is driven by law. So a chartered accountant with a legal background will be in a better position to assist the court, is my opinion. Not that others can't do it. So here the question was, this is a fact finding, is this? That person has put it and he gave it to questions. You have to send it to that other person, because whenever you allege 49 fraud, beyond all reasonable doubts, you have to establish. And 43, that time period is 1 year or 2 years. 1 year in case of normal persons, and 2 years in the case of a related party. That is to be a suspect period, they call. You have to establish. Fine. Even to establish, the company took a stand. No, it's not correct. We were operating at 90%. Company machinery is old. It cannot take more than that. Therefore, what we have done is a normal business transaction. How can you say it's a fraud? Now, when that matter came before us, we were asking the first question. What you are saying, you are operating at 60% only, should be established for last 1 year, 2 years. You are operating, there is surplus capacity there. Second is, this person has given to outsiders, whether there is a connection between the promoters and the other companies, it is a sister company, related party. That should be established. Third one, you have to prove the RP finding that, has he stopped that contract, has he cancelled it? And he has conducted his own manufacture and then proved that the cost incurred by him only this much compared to the cost incurred by them is that much. The difference is so much money. Thereafter, this difference of money has been siphoned off by who? The promoters. If this related party, how to recover that money? What order you have to make sure that adjudicating authority passes? You have to tell, assist the court. You are not there to test the knowledge of the court. You have to present the matter in such a way, argue in convincingly and prove the point. So, very rarely you become successful only because of these reasons. So, it is, you should not think adjudicating authority, based on the material placed before them, they will decide. That's all. You cannot expect them to read and then come to a conclusion and all. Then you should support them with the evidence, very simply. This much book, who will read? No one can read. No one can read. The point of law that you have to take should be very, very simple. That is where young lawyers will be successful. It's a common sense. That means you have to spend a lot of time. You have to prepare everything. You must guess what questions the judge can ask. And you take time, 1 day, 2 days. Whether it is a senior counsel, junior counsel, not, doesn't matter to it. If you take three jurisdictional judges we have seen in experience, Honorable Prakash Kumar sir, Honorable Sucharita madam, Honorable Varadarajan. Each judge has got certain great strengths. And some judges read all the things presented in short manner, first step. Then they put their knowledge, and because they have experience. Another judge has tremendous knowledge. By presentation itself, may come to the judgment. And then, when the order is reserved, they will go and read everything. It's not that they will blindly pass. But if you give them 100 orders, naturally nobody can pause properly. But your duty is to see that you will win in NCLAT or Supreme Court. You see, if even if adjudicating authority favors you for whatever reason, the other man will file, the matter should stand in the appeal. That is the 43, 49, 60. I am preparing a detailed notes, international law, everything. We will present it in the next video. This with regard to protection of RP, repeatedly that RP is the officer of the court. Liquidator is the officer of the court. He is given certain tasks. The law lays down, he will do. If suppose he is not doing, first chance is he should be asked to correct it. See, he is a child of the court. The person is tasked with reviving the business. He is not an ordinary person, RP and all. Whether the people there are knowledgeable or not, that's a different matter. Whether the people are swindling money or not, that's a different matter. But you have to presume that they are the officers of business. Has got fast decision making day to day. Same decision next day you can't take. You can't bring it to regulations. Though this has to go by regulation driven, procedure driven. Only when the malafide intention is established on the liquidator, RP or insolvency professional, the court has to recommend action to IBBI. And most times you are confronted with forces of threats, then the adjudicating authority is the only help to it. Workers create a lot of troubles. What you can do? You plead with them, you give them time, and if you go yourself, they'll beat you. You can't say I will go and then get it beaten and all. But then the police will not help you. Highly political. This is a corporate debtor is having a lot of land. All politicians will come. Bankers will take money. Most of the top bankers, our experience shows, I don't know how they're keeping that much of cash with them after demonetization and all. But then this is a fact. And so, the resolution professional must be given a good support by the police, must be directed to help them. That is the one. With regard to section 12.1.2.3, it is only you have to give extended time, and COC driven decisions there. Adjudicating authority role is only to ensure that time limitation of these things. Indefinitely giving more time is not being done. So the next video we'll take up for discussion is how to approve the resolution plan. What are the issues concerning the resolution plan? And then the liquidation process, various cases that we have experienced, how we have argued, we'll be taking up for discussion.